Welcome to the Open Back Top Sew Along. We've been sewing along all week. If you're just joining us, that's okay. This is the open back top that I've turned into a dress. So this is a pattern by Green Style Creations, and I'm going to sew it live with you today. I am going to be using some really yummy soft yoga knit. This pattern is great for a lot of different types of fabrics. You could make it in something like light, like double brush poly or cotton lycra, or even like something really light, like a bamboo lycra. You could also make it in a thicker fabric, an athletic fabric, or a yoga knit. It just has to have good stretch and recovery, about 25% stretch. So even, you know, a heavier sweatshirting fabric would work too if you're in a cooler climate. Right now we're still kind of in the middle of summer, so I'm going to be making a warm weather version. But I'm going to go ahead and start out. I'm going to do the front with the low neck. This is the low neck, and if you guys follow my blog at all, you know that I have a baby, so I need to have good nursing access. So I like the low neck, but there is a higher or a crew neck version. Sorry, cameraman's getting a little tilty there. There is a higher crew neck version that you can make as well, and there is a hooded version, and I show a picture of that in the sew along photo. So if you want to take a look at that, you can go to my blog, sewingwithsarah.com, or you can, you know, just check out some of the photos that they have up in the sew along event for the hooded version. So that's for the front. For the back, you can either do a low scoop or a high scoop. This is considered the high scoop. So it doesn't show too much of the back. The low scoop tends to go a lot lower, and I did make a pink version out of some Knit Pop Yoga Knit that was a low scoop. And then you have the option too of like a racer back or a mesh insert, which I think is really cool. I don't have a matching mesh, so I'm not doing the mesh insert, but I really love that option. And then it has a variety of sleeve lengths as well. So the first thing that I need to do, of course, is to cut out my fabric. I have my pattern here that I've traced onto medical exam paper. It's really inexpensive. You can buy it on Amazon, and it's thin like tissue paper, but it comes in a really big roll, so you can, you know, kind of be economical with that. If I really, really love a pattern, I'll trace it on like a Swedish tracing paper. But oftentimes I use this medical exam paper, especially when I'm going to be making any changes to the pattern. So the first thing that I need to do is fold my fabric. I did a video tutorial on my blog about how to find the grain line on knits, and I'll just kind of repeat that really quickly here. Essentially, knit fabric, if you could zoom in here, has these little ribs. The stretch is going this way, but the ribs go up and down along the fabric, and I just kind of pinch that and make sure that my fold is along one of those ribs, just to make sure that the fabric is on grain. If you have something that you cut off grain, it's going to twist. So that is kind of how I do that. Yeah, hey Michelle, yeah, I was sideways for a second. I think I'm good now. So I'm going to go ahead and cut this out. I'm going to start with the front, and I don't have a really long cutting table, so I tend to just, you know, kind of cut one piece at a time. And sometimes that's kind of a more economical way to use fabric as well. So I've got my front pattern piece here. Got my rotary cutter. I don't know how I'd survive without one. Every so often I'll see somebody say, well, is a rotary cutter really necessary for sewing? And I absolutely would say yes. I mean, you can certainly cut with your scissors, but it makes a much cleaner line. So I'm just gonna go ahead and start cutting my fabric here. And I use these metal washers. I think we got these from the hardware store as pattern weights. Some people use like soup cans. So hot, I don't even wanna think about soup right now. So I've got my metal pattern weights. I didn't mention this pattern obviously does come with a tank option as well. So it's hot where you are. There's another cut line for a tank. Just gonna go ahead. Sometimes this shifts a bit. Often I'll cut my pattern out with my rotary cutters before I even put it on my fabric. Not any chance of it shifting. You can see this is just really thin. Just crumple it up. throw the extra away. So there is my front that I cut out. Got that piece. Got the low neck there. Now I need to refold my fabric. Again, finding that grain line. Sometimes if I've got a really shifty fabric, I'll pin along that fold. In this case, the stuff is actually pretty well behaved. I love yoga knit. So I'm gonna do the high scoop back, which is what I'm wearing now. And just line that up. Second, not quite on the grain there. Straighten it out. Now this one is I really want to make sure that I always mark where the fold line is for this high scoop back and low scoop back, because the way that the scoop is, it can be kind of confusing about which is the armhole and which is the top. So I always just kind of mark that to make my life easier. Now there is a hem band on this pattern that I'll be using. If you don't like the idea of a hem band, you'll want to lengthen it, because otherwise it's just way too short. It's designed for a hem band that's a few inches wide. There is also an option for a plain back. So if you just want a good old tank top, you could do that as well. Okay, so there is my high scoop. All right. Got my back, lower back cut. Now I need to cut the upper straight back. So that's this little piece. And I'm going to fold it a little bit more. That also gets cut on the fold. Okay. So I've got that. You could also do some really neat color blocking. Someone in the sew along was doing some fun color blocking with this pattern, and I hadn't thought of that myself, but I really loved the look. So that's a fun option too that you might not consider if you're somewhat creatively challenged like me. So this, now I need to cut my sleeves. And in this case, I actually haven't ever done a sleeved version before. But I'm gonna be doing sleeves on this one.
They think you're wasting too much fabric on the side.
Oh, I'm sorry, Gloria. Am I a fabric waster? Okay, I'll dig the scraps out and make a thong out of them. How about that? If you guys haven't seen the new thong pattern from Grain Style, I have a blog post about it. That's just entertaining, if nothing else, even if you don't like thongs. And we actually will be doing a sew along at some point for those thongs. So, okay, I'm gonna be a good girl and refill my fabric just enough. I know this yoga knit is precious. I should be careful about how I use it. Okay.
Thanks, Gloria. I appreciate the tips.
That's our money manager talking right there. Okay, so got our sleeve. Need to cut two of them, of course. This one's going to be cut on the fold as well. Okay. And we'll see. This is a pretty short sleeve, almost like a kind of like a cap sleeve, I think. We'll see how it turns out, but that's how it's supposed to be done. And this, the fit of this top is pretty loose. So technically I should be grading.
Hold on. Pause. Live again.
Okay. Still more internet issues. I blame Facebook. So I'm going to keep going here and hopefully you guys can see me. Comment if you can see me. Okay, thanks, Rissa. Okay, so I'm gonna keep on cutting my sleeves. I was saying that this is kind of a loose fit top, so if you're between two sizes, you're like me and your hips are a different size than your bust, I would just go, you know, with your bust measurement. It is pretty flexible, in my opinion, in terms of the fit, it's a looser fit. And you can always take it in at the sides too. If you feel like it's too loose, you know, you just bring it in a little bit. You don't have to be, you know, have it exactly the way that it was designed. If you want a looser fit then, or more generous fit or tighter fit, then you can just customize that. Okay, so now I need to cut my hem bands. I have my front and my back, my upper back, and my sleeves. The hem band on this pattern, instead of being cut on the fold, which is how many hem bands are, this one is actually cut in two pieces so that you have two side seams. The seams are gonna be, you know, at the sides. So that's kind of nice because I think, you know, it just, those seams don't look as obvious as if there was just one in one spot. So I'm gonna go ahead and cut my hem bands. Okay. Gloria's gonna laugh at me if I run out of fabric because I was wasteful. I also think this top would make a really cute zip-up hoodie, and I'm actually working on a hack for that now. So I recommend thinking about that too. If you're like, well, I like it, but I'd really like it to be a zip-up, it's pretty easy to modify, and I'll be showing how to do that at some point on my blog. I had a little sewing machine. Two of the most important appliances in my house broke this week. The air conditioner, pretty important, and my sewing machine, also very important. So I had a friend who I actually didn't even know that she sewed, but she loaned me her sewing machine. So if you see sewing machine and I seem like I'm not very familiar with it, it's because I'm using a loaner. It's kind of like going to a different grocery store. Have you ever gone to like the grocery store across town that you never go to? And then you go to find like the cereal and it's in a totally different aisle. That's sort of how I feel about borrowing a sewing machine. Nothing's where I expect it to be. Okay, so now the last thing that we're gonna need to cut are the bindings. And since I'm doing sleeves, I don't need any arm bindings like I have on this one. I used arm bindings. You don't have to bind the back. You can kind of zoom in on this back. You can see that I did bind the back, both the lower back and the upper back in this one, which is a little bit off pattern. You can see the binding. The pattern calls for either turning the edges under on the lower back, so there's that back scoop, either turning those edges under and just stitching on the top, which is a great option if you're doing something, if you're using a heavier knit, like a sweatshirt knit, you don't necessarily need to bind that unless you just really want that look. So you could do that. You could just turn it under. If you're gonna do that on a thinner fabric, you might wanna use some sort of knit stay tape. At least that's what, you know, my serger, and my Cudver stitch does much better when I use knit stay tape, and this is what I use. You can buy it, you know, online, you can buy it on Amazon, Soakeasy, fine fusible knit stay tape. So this is what I use. It just adds a little bit of extra kind of structure so that when I do turn down an edge and just stitch on top, it does better. But I also like the look of the binding, so that's what I'm gonna be doing today. I have a video on my blog, sewingwithsarah.com, that is how to do the binding on the open back top. So if this is a part of the pattern where, you know, you haven't tackled that yet, or you're not sure if you're doing it right, I would recommend doing that. I tend to, there are measurements included in the pattern for the binding. I kind of tend to just cut, one big piece that's longer than I need. So that's about 1.5 inches wide.
Sorry, Gloria.
And then I'll just adjust the length as I go. So there's one piece. Use that for the lower back. I can use a slightly shorter one. 1.5 inches wide for the upper back piece. And then I also need a neck band. You can do a binding or a band on the neck. This is a binding. A lot of people aren't sure what a binding versus a band is. So I just kind of want to mention that real quick. So this is a binding. So what it's done is it's serged on, flipped over to the wrong side, and then stitched on top. And I did do that with my cover stitch, but you can use a sewing machine. This is a band. So this is a band that a piece of fabric, fold it in half, and then serged it right sides together to the neckline and just flipped it up. So it's not turned over again. And so that's what, you know, I find that's definitely easier, but a binding looks really clean. Looks clean on both sides usually. So, you know, you can kind of look at that you know, and decide. A band adds, got a little bit of dust on me. A band adds extra width to the neckline or the arm, wherever you're putting it on, because it's adding a little bit of extra, which in this case is good. I like that. But a binding is just kind of turning it over the edges. So it's not usually adding any extra width if you're really just wrapping the fabric over, maybe a teeny tiny bit, but not very much. So that's, selling my scraps, that would be funny. So that's kind of the difference there. In this case, I'm gonna also cut a piece for the neck band. So my neck is gonna be banded. So I'm gonna do that. And these are all, you know, the stretch is running up and down these pieces. This is a low neck, so I'm probably going to need a little bit more than that. I always, always, always measure my own neck band pieces. You know, I mean, you can usually trust the measurements, but every fabric is different. And so, you know, if you're using a cotton jersey, that's going to have a different stretch and need a different measurement for a band than, let's say, you know, a yoga net or mesh poly. So I always kind of take my fabric and think about, okay, how stretchy is this? How much stretch does it need in order to lay flat? If your neck band is sticking up or kind of drooping down, that means that it wasn't stretched enough. If it's gathered, that means that it was too stretched. So you can kind of guess and see. I usually cut my bands between 75 and 85%. Depending on the stretch of the fabric. So I think we've got all our pieces cut out. I'm gonna save these scraps for something, I promise. Hold on to them. So the first thing that we're gonna do in this pattern is construct the back. So I'm gonna grab my back pieces from over here. I've got the side, which is the right side of the fabric. Sometimes on yoga knit, really hard to tell. But I guarantee if you can't tell, probably nobody else is going to either. So pick the side you like best, use it, you're good to go. Okay, so I'm going to do a binding on that lower scoop. And what I'm going to do for that is I'm going to take one of my pieces and I'm going to, again, find the right side. And I'm going to serge it, tugging ever so slightly. I'm actually going to need the longer piece. With the right side of the binding to the wrong side of the back. Okay, so the right side of the binding is going to the wrong side of the back. And I'm going to serge that on. I'm going to tug it just a little bit, but really just a very, very little bit. So hopefully cut a long enough piece. Looks like I'm good. So I'm going to go over here to my serger. You guys can follow me, kind of see what we're doing here. Sorry guys, don't want to get too Blair Witch Project on you. Okay, so I'm gonna just serge that on. I do use MaxiLock Stretch in my loopers. I find that it makes actually a really big difference. in how my seams feel. They're softer. And I think it just makes for, the machine just seems to function better. If you're gonna pull this, you're gonna, the most of the tugging, you just tug it very slightly, but that's gonna be around that curve so that it hugs your back and doesn't gape open. Okay, so you can see I didn't get any gathering. That's good, you don't want any gathering. I'm gonna come to my iron over here. Looks like it's still warming up. Find my knit, my yoga knit. Does okay on a wool setting. I mean, you don't wanna be leaving it there for a long time, but. Presses pretty well. Looks like I need to tighten my tension on my serger a little bit. So I'm pressing the seam up toward the binding. And then this is the right side of the top now. And then I'm just gonna fold it over and iron there. And I kinda just fold and iron, fold and iron. You just wanna, I mean, the important thing is that it just be, you know, an even, consistent amount. So if you want to, you can just go through and iron your fold, one fold first, and then iron. So then I'm just gonna go back and iron that second fold a little bit. And then I like to use pins. You can use, you know, whatever works for you. Even wash away wonder tape if you really wanna hold that stuff down. If you got a really slippery fabric, wash away wonder tape will be helpful. Just gonna cut this. Make sure that it's even. So this binding, because I'm not, it's not a band, it's not really adding too much width to the lower back here. I'm just gonna do that all the way around. The key is that you just wanna fold it and make sure that you can't see that serged line. And the reason we stitch this way instead of doing it right sides together first is so that you have more control over what the stitching looks like on the right side. The right side is, you know, what people are gonna see from of your shirt, obviously, so you just want to make sure that they get the good view. You can tell the way that it's folding. And you'll probably catch the back edge just fine, but if you don't, you serge that part on, so you're going to be fine anyway. Okay, so I've got it all nicely pinned. You can do a little last minute adjusting if you want. And then, you know, like I said, you can use your sewing machine to stitch it down. You might want to use a longer straight stitch length if you're going to do that. But I'm going to go over here to my cover stitch machine. My cover stitch and I have a mixed history. Sometimes she's very cooperative. Sometimes she's not. So we're going to hope for the best today. And I do have it set again. But this one I'm using regular thread because I don't have maxi lock stretch in the right color. I like to grab this little serger tail back here and kind of just use that to kind of tug it forward because I think that it helps it catch. What's going on here? keeping some stitches. Like I said, she and I don't always get along. So I'm not sure. I'll loosen up the presser foot pressure here. That is just not working out the way that I like it. So I'm gonna go ahead and actually stitch that binding down in my sewing machine because I don't really wanna take up any more time to kind of fight with this. So you can see,
the other way.
No good. What are you doing? So you can see that it skipped some stitches there. Like I said, sometimes we get along and sometimes we don't. So you just see my seam ripper in action here. I tend to be kind of a perfectionist when I sew. So I have to undo it and go back and redo it because that kind of little thing would really drive me nuts. It was working really well yesterday. People are debating about the pros and cons of ironing. I know, sometimes I skip ironing too, but it does help. It does make it better. So I'm gonna just take this out. First I kind of rip the back out as much as I can, and then I go up in the front and grab one of those threads. And if you've done enough ripping on the back, just comes out. It's the beauty of these live videos, you know. If this weren't live, I would edit this part out, but you get to see the real experience here. So that one came out easily. So sometimes it's just the fabric, like it just doesn't like certain fabrics. It was doing really well on some yoga knit yesterday, so I thought we were good to go. I think the universe is just throwing me some curveballs tonight. This is why whenever anything's going wrong and I notice that it's going wrong on my sewing machine or my cover stitch or whatnot, I always stop. I think sometimes there's a tendency to just like, let's just keep going and see if it somehow miraculously works itself out. I know, wishful thinking, but usually it just ends up with more seam ripping, which is sad. So, actually, okay, so we're almost there. I almost got it all. So you get to see me in my borrowed sewing machine now, which actually seems to do a pretty decent job. If you're using a sewing machine, you want to make sure that you're using a needle that's made for knits, so a ballpoint or a stretch needle, and that's equal to, you know, appropriate for the weight of your fabric. So if your fabric is really, you know, really lightweight, then you can use like a 75 needle. If your fabric is heavier, then you might want, you know, a 90, 80 or a 90. So just make sure that you're using the appropriate needle size for your fabric. Come on. That last little bit of thread, just really hanging on. Come on. This stuff really wants to snag. So I don't want to bore you guys. I'm going to leave it alone for now. I'm going to come over to my sewing machine. This is the one that I am borrowing. Find a thread that's matching. And let's see. That looks like a nice match. I'll go with that. And they have some special type of So this is a Singer. I usually have a Brother machine, so they're somewhat different in ways that I didn't expect. And there were some things that I super appreciate the opportunity to borrow this machine, but there were some things that I took for granted about my old sewing machine. So I am learning how to kind of redo that. I've decided that it's going to bother me if the bobbin thread's not the exact same color, so I'm going to wind a new bobbin really quick. Should be good. So this one has, my brother just has this kind of drop-in bobbin, but this one has this kind of little bobbin case. So stick that in here. Some people find a lot of success using a walking foot for knits, and if you feel like your fabric is stretching out, I would recommend that. I'm not using a walking foot here, and actually in my last few days of using this machine, I found that it actually does pretty well. Thank you. Without a walking foot, but if you were sewing on something that really didn't have a lot of great recovery, you would want to maybe think about using a walking foot. Okay, so I'm going to kind of refold my binding here. I don't need that, thank you. And you're going to want to sew directly along that edge. So, will you take it off the tripod and kind of hold it for this part, please.
Sure.
So on this one, I'm just gonna line it up the edge. The other edge of my fabric is up against that presser foot. And I'm also going to lengthen my stitch length. So that it has a little bit of give, although this isn't going to stretch a ton. Okay. So you can kind of make sure that it's folding appropriately as you go, right, too. Having a lot of luck with this sewing machine either. Okay. You guys don't know, I have a post on Sale Friday. So as I go along, just kind of sewing it down. Adjusting. Okay. Fabric is not being terribly cooperative. I think that... come over to the lower back, and I'm actually going to do this the way that it says in the pattern, just for consistency. I'm going to put it right sides together and sew those two edges together. Bring up my computer again in case anyone has any question. Okay, so Carrie was asking about where the pattern is. It's inside the event, and there is a code for getting a discount on the pattern in the event. And then I did a blog post today on the Green Style Creations blog about how to turn it into the dress using the free green tea pattern and the open back top pattern together. So I kind of described that. So. You can definitely check that out if you like the dress. I was kind of trying to copy a ready-to-wear dress I have, so I'm happy with how it turned out. I'm going to come over here to my serger. And you can serge this, or you can sew it. The seam allowances in this pattern are 3/8 of an inch. So I'm serging that. Together. And then I'm going to come back here. And I'll serge this one right sides together. You can also use your sewing machine for this step. If you want to. Back and forth so that we can see a little bit better. Okay. So with this side, just want to make sure that it's lining up correctly. Your sewing machine or your serger. And I'm just going to go ahead and serge that together. Back and the lower back together. Now on this dress I bound the upper back as well, but since my cover stitch wasn't cooperating, I don't think I'm going to do that. So just turn that top edge under and press. And this is and then you're just going to sew across that upper back. So come back over to the sewing machine. Just sew that down. Oops. Okay. I'm a little bit concerned that this is going to stretch out. So what I'm actually going to do now, I'm going to use, so look, I kind of had some tendency to do that. I'm going to use a little wash away wonder tape and just stabilize that edge a little bit. So to do that, I'm just going to run the wash away wonder tape along here. Along that upper back. And then you peel it away. If you haven't ever used this stuff before, it's pretty awesome. It does like the name says, just wash away in the first wash. And it just kind of helps hold those seams. It provides a little extra stabilization if needed. Serger tail there makes it a little uneven, but you could also serge this upper back if you wanted to. I wish I had, because I feel like it would look cleaner, but and you can kind of readjust it too, which is another thing that I like about the Wonder Tape, is you can adjust that. Like if I don't like the way that it folded down, just peel it up, try again. Okay. Yeah, so I've got a little wrinkle here, which is one that can be fixed. That's our bedtime alarm for our kids, but they're getting an extension today. So if you don't like the way that that has turned out, just kind of repress it. Having trouble getting that little wrinkle out. So, I'm going to go ahead and, wrong machine, sew that together. And again, on all of my others, I did this with the other machine, but on this one, I'm going to try to do it on here. Alright, so I've got the top sewn and give it a little quick press here. I'm actually probably going to go back later tonight and fix that bottom curve because I'm not happy with how it's looking. But okay, so we have the back assembled. Now we need to attach it to the front. I know, me too, Angie. I waited too long too. That's what happens when you wait too long. It's just I never want to take a break from my sewing to take my machines in for maintenance, which is terrible because then they force me to at bad times. Okay, so I'm gonna attach the front and the back shoulders. If you kind of zoom in here, you'll notice that there's a little overhang. This is actually really good. This is good drafting. Because that means that when you sew the seam allowance at 3/8 of an inch, that it's going to line up exactly along that point. If the front was exactly the same width as the back sleeve, when you sew at 3/8 seam allowance, it would not line up. So that's definitely a good thing. So some people look at that and go, oh, that's not right. It is. It's supposed to be like that. So I'm going to go ahead and serge that edge at 3/8. And then I'm going to do the other one. Okay. thinner knit. I mean, you could do it with this one too, but if you're using a thin knit, like a t-shirt knit or something like that, you would probably want to stabilize the back edges with some clear elastic or with some of that like knit stay tape that I mentioned, just so that the shoulders don't stretch out over time. You'll notice that there's clear elastic in a lot of your ready-to-wear garments too. So now I'm going to be attaching the sleeves because I'm using sleeves. You want to find, these sleeves are cut on the fold, so you want to find the center of the sleeve. I make a teeny little snip there. That's what gets lined up with the right side here, right with that shoulder seam. And make sure your shoulder seams are pressed toward the back of the shirt when you're attaching your sleeves, your neck binding, and your neck band. And then I'm just bringing over here. I'm going to pin over here at this corner. And then pin over here at this corner. And then I kind of take a look at that. Make sure that the fabric is stretched well. Can you see that? Can you guys see what I'm doing there? And then pin the sleeve like that. I usually don't stretch much down here, closer to the underarm, and then I stretch the sleeve cap a bit more toward the top of the shoulder. Okay. So it's one sleeve, and then I flip the shirt around. Grab the second sleeve. Again, have a little internal debate with myself about which is the right and which is the wrong side of this knit. Cut a little snip. All right. Align that with the shoulder. Put it toward the back. Can they see what I'm doing here, Steven?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just want to make sure it's visible. Let me know if there are any comments that I need to address. Okay. We've got that one pinned. I'm going to come over here, pin this other edge together. I like these little clips too. I use pins and clips pretty equally. The pins are really nice for things where the clip will leave an indentation, but the clips are fast, and that's definitely an advantage sometimes. Okay, so I've got my sleeves both pinned in, so I'm gonna go over to the serger. I'm gonna serge those on.
Sorry about that. We're low on battery, so I'm connected to it.
Okay. Okay, when I get to that shoulder seam again, I'm just gonna, you know, peek. Okay, here's the back of my top. I'm making sure that that shoulder seam is pressed toward the back. You're gonna go right over that seam on the back. I'm always always pausing as I serge to make sure nothing's like bunched up under there. That's always irritating when you get to the end and it's all bunched up. Okay, so got that. Gonna flip it over to the other sleeve. And I always like to serve with the sleeve on top. I feel like it's easier to make sure that it doesn't get bunched when I do that. So I'm always kind of flipping it around to make sure I can sew both sides with the sleeve on top. Okay, so again, I'm figuring out where the back is and then flipping that seam so that it's pressing toward the back. Constructed, the back constructed, you need to attach those side seams. If you were doing the arm binding, you would have already sewn the side seams and then the binding, but since I'm doing these sleeves. Now for this, when you're lining up underarm seams, I'm just a little OCD about this, I guess. I really like my seams to line up really nicely, and I think that technically you're supposed to push or press the sleeve seam maybe toward the sleeve or down toward the bodice. I end up pressing one each direction because that makes it really easy for me to line up that underarm seam. That may not be the official way of doing it, but that means that your underarm seams are always matched up, and that always drives me nuts in ready-to-wear garments when the underarm seams are not matched up. I know you guys are all checking your armpits right now, but that drives me crazy. So I always like to have them matched up. So that's how I do it. One direction, one the other direction. It also reduces bulk if you're going to go over a seam with your cover stitch. Sometimes pressing one way and one the other way makes it easier for your cover stitch to jump that seam. So then I just use a pin for the rest of it. And it's going to seem really short because remember, we haven't added that hem band. Green style drafts for people that are much taller than I am, or like 5'8", and I'm pretty far from that, but I have a really long torso compared to my legs, so I don't lengthen or shorten the shirts at all. So this is going to be, just how it is without being shortened. I'm going to go ahead and serge that together. Commented that their open back top gaped at the bottom of the back. That hasn't been a problem for me. I had one where it seemed like maybe it was going to, and I just took in the side seam and it fixed the problem. So if that's a problem for you, I think it's probably more likely to happen on the lower back, the lower scoop back, than the higher scoop back. But you can always take in the sides like just at that point and maybe have it so that it stretches a little bit across your back more. You could make an alteration like on the paper pattern to adjust for that, but if you're doing it during construction, that's what I would recommend trying. You can always baste it if you're not sure what effect it's going to have. I would baste it, see what happens. Okay, said, this is a looser fitting top, so sewing the side seams is an option to adjust it to your preference. This dress was taken in quite a bit from the original pattern, more closer to the shaping of the green tee. Okay, so now we have something that's starting to resemble a top. Ta-da! Okay, so there are a couple things that you could do at this point. If you're adding a hood, you could add the hood now. If you're doing, you know, a hem band, which is what I am doing, that's how you're gonna finish that bottom. You're not gonna need to turn it up and stitch. So to do that, I'm gonna sew my hem band pieces together really quick. And then we're gonna still have to do the neck band on mine since I'm not doing the hooded option. So come over here. Once you get that back sewn, it really goes together really quickly. Other side seam, so these are going to match up with the side seams of the top. Okay, so this is a really wide band. First, I'm going to press the seams a little bit. Press that other side. And then this is where we're going to fold it in half. I did a kind of tip tutorial on my blog the other day about sewing these types of seams and how to keep them bumpy, you know, from being bumpy. I'm not doing it today because I don't have a regular sewing machine, but a lot of times like that serge seam in there tends to like wiggle around and create bumps if it's not all facing the same direction. So what I would actually recommend that I did not do is to sew it with your sewing machine. Sew it with a stretch stitch using your sewing machine and then press it open. And then that creates a really nice flat seam there for bands and bindings. That's a really good way to keep it kind of flat and from being bumpy. And there's, like I said, on Sewing with Sarah, there's a little video tutorial. I have a tutorial section on the menu bar, and you can just go to that if you want to check out that tutorial. It's on there. It's a little video, quick one, couple minutes long for how I do that. So I'm going to be doing this there. I just usually clip four spots. Now you do want to find like center front and center back. So to do that, I'm going to line up the side seams. And where did my pins go? I'm going to grab a pin. This is a part, when I was first sewing, I would read a tutorial that said how to, you know, just quarter your neck band or quarter your band. And I would say, what does that mean? How do I quarter my band? So it's essentially dividing it into four sections that are equal. So I put those seams together here. Seams are together. And then I'm going to put a pin in the fold on the side. And there's already a clip over here. I did a pretty good job with that one. So now when you look at your top, we're going to do the hem band in this case. So the side seams, fold it, fold those so that they're together. And this works for the neck band too, of course, you know, the center front and the center back of the shirt. So the quartering points are not the shoulders. That's really important. 99% of the time, it's not the shoulder, unless your pattern pieces are the same on the front and the back. which is fairly unusual. So these seams are going to line up with those side seams. So I'm just going to go ahead and do that. Now this is another spot where it's really nice to have those seams line up. So it's usually take my pin and stick it through, and then I check. I peel it back and I say, okay, is that lining up really well right there? And if it is, then I'm good to go. If it's not, then I adjust. Clip the center of the band there. And then again, go back over here to this other side. You want to make sure that your band is even all the way around. It's folded evenly. Grab pin. You also want to make that pin at exactly 3/8 so that, because that's where you're going to sew. Now this isn't getting stretched a lot. You know, some bands that you'll put on, when we do the neck band, you'll see that one's going to get stretched. This isn't getting stretched a ton. So it makes it a lot easier. You can see they're pretty much just lining up exactly same width. So I'm going to go through, I'm going to serge these together. This is three layers now. And then I'm going to come back and do the neck band. And then we're going to do the hem, and then we're good. Okay. Again, I'm just lining up all three of those layers. Making sure that they're lined up. If you really, really, really want to make sure that they line up perfectly, you might baste it, especially at those side points. Looks like I'm playing chicken with my serger thread up here. It's getting kind of low. I ordered three more today. Almost there. I know you guys probably feel like I produce a lot of clothing, but I'm honestly not that fast of a sewer. I'm just stretching this as I go. You shouldn't be stretching it to the max because you don't want gathers, but you do want to be stretching it a bit so that it lays nice and flat. And again, I'm going to press that seam toward the back, just like you did when you were doing your sleeves. So the stretching is what makes the curve kind of hug your body. So. Here we go. It's going around. Making sure that all three layers are lined up well. And again, I'm using a band. You could bind it if you'd rather do that. But I like doing this, so. Put the band on, make sure that seam is pressed well. So I've gotten it sewn on, and once I give it a little press, it's gonna lay just perfectly. I'm gonna trim off that little tail. So let me go ahead and do that, and then you're gonna see, I'm just gonna hem the sleeves, and then that's it, you've got a top. Now some fabrics do not take that pressing well, so you wanna be careful, depending on the type of fabric you're using. It may not want to be pressed. In which case, you can just top stitch it without pressing it, or you can use, like, try using a pressing cloth, maybe on a scrap of fabric, and see if that helps. You certainly have the option of top stitching down the neckline. Sometimes I do that, sometimes I don't. On this one, I think I'm gonna skip it. Now, I need to hem the sleeves. The problem with this fabric, much as I love it, is it does not hold a press very well. So, what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna show you a little trick that I use, and that is to run a basting stitch at the hem, where you want the hem to be, and then to use that to fold under. So that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna set my machine to a really long, new machine here. Okay, I'm gonna really long stitch. The longest this one will go is 4.5 millimeters. So just gonna go ahead and place my sleeve over there and run a basting stitch at my seam allowance. And then I just take that out when I'm done. I can eyeball it, and sometimes I do, but you don't want one sleeve to be really short and one sleeve to be long. Just take that out. Gather the fabric though, so I'm just going to be kind of careful about that. Put under again, next side, same way. So now I've got a nice basting stitch. I'm gonna make sure it didn't gather it. Then I get rid of the gathers. And I can use that to show myself where I want that fold to be when I turn it under. And then I can go ahead and cover stitch that. So this is what I'm gonna do, because it's not pressing real well. Come over here to my cover stitch machine. And again, I like to start at the back near the underarm, just so that any spot where you're not 100% even does not show up. So. Start going, make sure it's doing its job there. It seems to be just fine. block my cover stitch stitches. So I'm gonna grab my scissors, lift up the presser foot. I'm gonna sweep them down under there, bring the needle threads forward, and then bring the garment directly toward the back. And that ties it off in the back. For a little extra sense of security, sometimes I will tie it again, but you don't, you know, you shouldn't have to. If you're locking it off correctly, you shouldn't have to. So then I would go back and pick out those basting stitches, which should be easy if you used a long stitch length. Should be easy to pick them out. So I'm gonna go over here. Again, starting at the underarm, folding it under. Foot, sweep those needle threads toward the front, bring my shirt toward the back, flip that off. Okay, so put the threads in the back. Now it's just a matter of taking out those basting stitches. But after you do that, your top is finished. So you have an open back top, super cute. That you can be proud of. So keep a watch, keep a lookout. You can check out the hack for this dress on the Green Style Creations blog. Go to greenstylecreations.com. And blog is one of the links, and you can go there and check out the dress hack. You can also check out my binding videos on my blog, sewingwithsarah.com, and I will be putting this video up on my blog as well if we can link it all together, all the pieces of it. That'll go up on my blog, and then stay tuned for another hack for this top. Don't forget to post your tops if you did sew along with me, and you're going to post something. You have until Monday to post that in the album in the event to be entered to win a prize. So thank you for sewing along today. Have a good night.